morning, as I mentioned in Monday's class, we have Danielle Zinger. She's going to be talking about optimization at a very high level. Right? So we've been talking 4G now. There's another course that a lot of our graduate students take with Dr. Schwartz, 752 for more optimization. Danielle's gone past that level and really applying it. So she's got a lot of technical background, but she's not going to cover any of that in class today. She's going to cover high-level applications of it over her very broad-based career. She's worked at Honeywell for several years, University of Rio de Janeiro. She was a faculty member there, then came back to Canada, and now been just over 2 years at Hatch, applying optimization every day for her work. So please ask Danielle lots of questions. There's time at the end, but in the middle, please interject and ask if you're not sure on something. As you all know, this is part of a course, right? So this is as if I'm lecturing here. In other words, it's part of tests and exams and make sure you understand what's going on. So thank you, Danielle, for joining us. And goals of each of the stakeholders in the optimization world.
this dotted line here still represents the physical blender, but within the physical blender, you have three different modes of operation. You can see them. And depending on the mode of operation, so grape juice here, you're only connected to the grape, concentrate, and water. You do not have anything connected to your pores. So these are what we call pores. So those pores don't have any connections when it's in this mode, but when the blender is in this mode, it is connected to those two concentrates. Okay, so now too. So what they were doing was getting many different types of oils and passing them through this piece of equipment called a deodorizer, because you don't want margarine to smell like fish oil. So they basically blasted the oil with steam to take the odors off. Now they had 53 different types of oils that could come into their system, and seven different groups the oils belong to. So depending on which group went through this deodorizer unit, you would have to run an empty tray. There were different trays inside this deodorizer unit. You would have to run an empty tray to clean it out before you put in the other group. So fish oil, for instance, you would have to run an empty tray after. So the goal of this study was to minimize the number of empty trays that you had to pass through this piece of equipment. The interesting thing about this was that we do a lot of consulting up front, because we need to understand the process from the scheduling perspective, which is really that trade-off that you asked about. So people aren't used to thinking about their process in certain ways. They're super experts in their own processes, for sure, much more than we are, but we have to ask certain questions in order to be able to construct a model in our own mind so that we can translate that into a scheduling model. So one of the questions that we asked was, okay, so what is the grouping of oils into groups? Right? That was the very first question that we needed to ask them. And then the scheduler had been working there for 37 years and let me think. What do you mean, let me think? You don't have that documented? So it wasn't even documented. The guy was about to retire. He said, what happens when you're about there? Oh yeah, productivity goes down by about 20%. Yeah, because people were, it's never infeasible. It's just that people would run for longer because they needed more empty trays between the oils. So it was an pressing issue, but productivity would go down, and they'd have overtime on the weekends because of that. So even the consulting exercise of trying to understand the process and asking these questions already improved their system, even before doing any mathematical modeling. So just thinking about their production in some ways helps. Okay, so this is gas processing. I'll just skip through those. This is a steel example, which is interesting because each one of the products, the connectivity here is really important, because each one of those five different types of products that they produce has a different path here in the system. So depending on which mode of operation these pieces of equipment are in, products pass through them in certain orders or not, so it's interesting that way. And under unconventional applications of UOX, because it's the same, this is a very generic tool. So even for business development, I suppose, we modeled a Sudoku puzzle with UOX for real. People didn't believe me, but it was true. Like, we actually modeled it using standard UOX representation in a baseball scheduling tournament as well, using the same exact set of equations where, you know, the referees, you would have an inventory unit of referees, an inventory unit of teams, and then you have to draw from that unit and get it back so that you would know the availability of referees. So things like that. So if you get creative in your modeling, and it's really, really fun. Now, I'm more involved with hydro operations. It's also the planning and scheduling of hydroelectric generation. So I've moved a little bit away from the process industries, because my previous slide, and gotten more into the power generation side of things. So it's basically, you have reservoirs, and you generate energy from those reservoirs. And you come under here, and it's up over to reservoirs, and says, okay, that's a series of tanks. Didn't get too many friends by saying that, but that's okay. But I actually did prove my point, because I did fit a first story with dead time curve on that thing, and it's a perfect fit. But anyway, I digress. So the large reservoirs, you have different goals depending on the horizon. So the long-term goals of your reservoir system is the water management plan. So you're concerned about the level, water levels in your reservoirs. Yes, you're concerned with generation as well, but you have the inflows that vary a lot across the year. So you have the spring freshet, which is when a lot of rain, and then summer is down, and then it goes back up. So you have those profiles across the year. So you have to manage water, make sure that you have enough water for satisfy all your constraints. The short-term goals, your system, which is looking out a couple of weeks on an hourly basis, is to minimize the amount of water that you spill. Because either you use the power to generate, either you use the water to generate power, or you spill that water, so you waste it in terms of the energy that you could be generating with it. So the work with asset management solution, basically making a trade-off between, you have an aging facility, so in hydroelectric facilities, it's very common to see plants that are 100 years old. So these little equipment can get old as well after 100 years. So you have to decide what to do. Do you replace these pieces of equipment, or do you face the risks of it breaking down and having excessive outages? So there's a trade-off there. What this product does, it has a database of probability of failure curves for each different type calculation, especially for short-term decisions that must be made on a regular basis, such as scheduling, that we actually incredibly impatient. Scheduling models for you for a long time. It's okay for academic research, but in industry, it could take longer than 5 minutes for a scheduling model. People start, you know, getting a little bit of sleep. The tool should be easy to maintain by other developers, which is something we don't really think about when we're doing our own coding. But when there's other people that need to work with that code, it's really important that you not only document it properly so that other people can understand what you've done, but also link to the next one, which is the code architecture. Like you have to, everybody has to work with the same architecture mindset in terms of the coding itself, so that everybody's doing things in a similar way in terms of the architecture, and that you're able to maintain it in the future and extend the functionality as well. And you know, you're not doing it now, but if you envision something that could happen in the future, okay, maybe the architecture there will do it now, but just leave enough room for you to go in and do it later. And ease of use is another important thing it should be. It has to be easy to use by the end user. So data, what is easy to use? Easy in terms of data entry, result interpretation, integration with the adjacent systems as well. And well, because that's really what guarantees is a big part of the long-term usage of the model in industry. So if it doesn't satisfy those constraints, people won't like using it, which it could be solving excellent problems, but if it's going to be difficult and clunky and there's going to be integration issues, that might be a short stop. IT challenges, which I've separated from our problems. Sorry, so I've made a difference between IT and R&D challenges in industry. IT challenges, one of them is compatibility with different previous versions of the tool, so you have to make sure that whatever you do, it doesn't break the system for whoever might be using it previous. Soldiers back and building issues that you need to be aware of. Choosing high level versus low level languages, if you're fortunate enough to be in that position to choose, because usually you just go into a situation, so you have to use whatever's there. But if you're fortunate enough to be in that situation, there's pros and cons. I don't think there is one right solution. Just be aware of the pros and cons of using high level versus low level tools. Yes, there's more IT skills needed to use C++. But on the other hand, in terms of long-term sustainability of the model that you rely on something like YAMS, sure, it's okay. But you just have to be careful about the risk overlaying on a high-level language, because there are some in the past, not YAMS specifically, but other languages that have stopped being supported. So if you do thousands and thousands of lines of code, and hundreds of thousands of lines of code on software, just make sure that you weigh the risks from relying on that tool to use it as a basis, because you might have to migrate to something in the future. And integration, IT integration, will be a good tool. That's all. Now, industrial R&D challenges, one of the biggest ones, I think, is the benefits analysis. Proving that what you're doing is better before you do. So it sounds easy, it's not. And it takes a lot of work to actually do a thorough benefits analysis. I've found over the years that what really helps, instead of discussing things, is just build a prototype. A very small prototype that you can build very quickly, and then you can use, you know, one of those high-level tools. And actually, there's a real tip for you. If you ever work with optimization, there's a great prototype tool called Solver Studio that's added to Excel. It's Solver Studio. So it basically integrates an Apple or YAMS interface with Excel, so you can, instead of having to work with a dev file in YAMS, you can actually capture the values from Excel cells and put it into your YAMS model and then spit it back out into Excel. So it's very fast for prototyping, and you can use, you know, the Excel visualization. The other challenge is managing existing tools and solutions. In terms of when you're in a big company, there may be other tools that do similar things like the one that you're proposing. So there's that debate of, do you extend the current tools or do you build something new? Lots of discussion can happen there. So there's a lot of knowledge management powerful technology, that's what they want. They don't want something that's, you know, super fancy if it's something to help them at the end of the day. That's what they want. They want something to make their life easier, not harder. They don't want to know about your constraints. They don't want to know about any of that complexity. They want to click the button and get a better solution than what they were getting before and with less work. That's what they want, okay? So accurate, fast, repeatable, and important, this last one. Solutions that can be understood and accepted, because in optimization, as we know by now, optimization tends to lead the model to the extreme of the constraint, right? Like you're there at the constraint. But if that constraint is a safety constraint, operators may not be really comfortable operating there. They might want to back off a little, because if anything happens, if a minor fluctuation happens, like they're over the edge. You know? So there's a really interesting talk from Chulorie, the Fuchs Institute, and it's online. Actually, you can watch a video of that talk. I highly recommend it, because it was one of the best real-time optimization talks I've ever watched. But he does address that in real-time optimization as well. So I highly recommend you watch that, because he does address this in a lot more detail. And challenges for them, essentially, they have to get work done. Okay, so it doesn't matter what, you know, you can try to explain why your tool has this problem or this bug, this and that, like, it doesn't matter to them. Like, they have to get the work done. So they don't want to see crashes, they don't want to see bad solutions, they don't want to see optimization problems that usually take 5 minutes, but all of a sudden it took 30 minutes to solve. Well, they don't want to see that, because they have to get their work done. They have other things to do. So that's the main challenge. If the technology creates problems, they'll have to deal with it. So and they have to decide whether they want to develop it in-house, for instance, if they have enough optimization expertise in-house versus if they're to buy. Model maintenance is the very last thing I'm going to talk about. I know I'm going to be a little bit of print time, but I hope to model maintenance, when you talk about optimization model maintenance, people usually start thinking about equations. Okay, so, model maintenance, so you go in and you change the parameters, this and that. It's one of the key issues affecting the long-term usage of optimization models in the industry. Usually, you deploy it, people are happy after a few years. Well, have you been using it? No, not really. Why not? Well, you know, things happen in the process, things change, and basically, you don't have time. So, my question is this only a math issue, or is there a very, very strong interface component to it? And I truly believe there's a huge user interface component to model maintenance, which is not being addressed. And I think this is a niche area for you guys that know IT and know optimization and know, like, the end user perspective in terms of the chemical processes to address this issue here. As a very quick example, this is an LP to decide how much of each food to buy in some nutritional constraint. Okay? If you give this to the user, the user will say, oh my gosh, what is this? You know, I don't want to use this. I just want to decide what to buy. Does it even consider vitamin C? I don't know. So, again, I'll just buy whatever I've bought in the past. I don't care. It's worked for me. You know, I might not be satisfied with vitamin C requirements, but, you know, I'm okay with it. And I know that I'll be able to pay for it. And so I'll do what I've always done, forget about it. This is what you hear all the time in coding scheduling systems. It's amazing. Well, we've always done it like this, so I know, like, this is the best way possible, because for years we've always done it like this. Well, not necessarily true. I'm sure they know their system very well, and I'm sure it works. But you have to understand why they don't think why they think it presents a solution. Why is that a bad solution? Why don't you like this solution? And then try to get them from that, because maybe you're missing a constraint. Okay, so improve the model then. We never go into feasible as another fallacy, because they have their infeasibility management already embedded in their system. So, oh no, we
How often do you come across stuff that you just, like, you know you can't, there's no way you could solve it or optimize it?
Come across it. There's different ways to solve. The thing is that you have to be careful about what the capabilities are, and you have to always keep that in mind when you're saying you can solve something. Everything is solvable. It just depends on what it is that people want to achieve. For instance, now, today, I'm working with a problem that they want me to solve a problem for a horizon of 4 days with a minute discretization. Try, but you know it's the expectation management. I don't think that will work, but on the other hand, do we really need, so there's always that conversation that goes on. So for this type of decision, do we really need to go down to the minute? So can we deal with 10 minute increments? 10 minutes, yeah, we can do something with 10 minutes. So minute, or do we need to look at 4 days? Do we need to look at a single day? Is that good enough? So there's a conversation that goes on in terms of that. There's a big disconnect as well. You might hear that. Difference between simulation and optimization. It's very clear in academia, when you get an industry, it gets fuzzy in people's mind. And it's completely different. The simulation will tell it what to do and it will tell you if it's feasible or not. Essentially, optimization, you generate what the best solution is. Simulation in a sense is a subset of optimization in a sense where you're fixing the variables, but because they do it in a sequential way, they can deal with finer representations of the system. So sometimes people expect simulation and optimization, at least in the planning and scheduling world. But it's a different mindset, so you have to learn how to manage that and set the expectations.
What proportion of optimization problems in the industry would you say are non-linear versus linear?
That's a tough question. It really depends on your area of application. Like people might be working with I'm currently working with an all-year system right now, but it really depends on your application area. I don't think there's a general solution to that, because some people might work with, you know, NLPs every day. Other people might work with this every day. They're both as prevalent. It really depends on the area, so it really depends. That one is a tough one to define. But you'll see, like, it really boils down to what is really key to defining the specifics of what it is that you're trying to achieve. So if you feel that something has to be described in all of its non-linear glory, you have to go non-linear. Right? But if you feel that a linear representation can get you to the decision that you need, by all means go linear if you can. But if you can go that way, then
okay, thank you.
So I hope that it's some inspiration for some of your projects, as well as potential future careers for all, career paths that many of you could follow. Daniel certainly covered a whole lot of ground in the past.